Good morning. It is Tuesday morning, and I think it's going to be a beautiful day today. I think we're going to have sunshine. I'm looking out the window. And I'm just excited about talking to you guys today about something that has become a huge part of my life, and that is conscious breathing and meditation and yoga. I'm really talking about the breathing part today and the meditation, but it's all been a huge part of my life for just over a year now. And I kind of stumbled on it because I'm one of those seekers. I'm one of those people that love to learn. Take these glasses off for a minute. I love learning about things that can help me. And I've had a lot of trauma in my life from childhood on. And so my main goal has been to be able to handle trauma and stress in a healthy way and become a better person because of it, and kind of, you know, be victorious instead of a victim. And so that part of my journey recently led me to a book called The Body Keeps the Score, and it is amazing. And if you love learning and you love nonfiction, you would love that book, The Body Keeps the Score. And in that book, it talks about trauma yoga. So last December, I went to, I don't know if y'all can see this, Costa Rica Passion Yoga School, and I took a 60-hour trauma yoga teacher training, and it was phenomenal, and I cannot wait to go back and do more training. But the main, one of the main components of this training was about conscious breathing and what it can do for us, for our bodies, for our emotions. And so I just wanted to read you my notes this morning. This is the kind of the review of what breath does. And the first thing I wrote down, because this is what I thought the whole time I was in the training, was like, oh my gosh, this is free medicine. Okay. You don't get much for free in this life, but breathing is free medicine, guys. It downregulates. It changes your brain. It can actually change the neuroplasticity of your brain. It can increase the prefrontal cortex, which is responsible for our executive functioning, decision making. It also is increases the thickness of it. So to me, that was amazing because, you know, I've always thought as an educator, I thought your brain's your brain and you really can't change your brain. And you know, you can do things to strengthen, but guys, you really can rewire your brain from trauma. All of those things in your emotional brain that get triggered by different things, and maybe we react in a way that we don't understand. It's because those memories and that trauma is stored in your emotional brain. And you really don't have any control. It's not like you can say, hey, calm down. This is not what you think it is. You know, we really don't have that ability to do that. And so we have to find a way to stop that fight or flight mentality, okay? And that is controlled in the amygdala right back here in the brain stem area, okay? That's where all of our subconscious, like we're not even consciously aware of this, guys, and it happens. When we get in that fight or flight mode, we are totally in survival mode. And like there's just lots of things we might do, that we're not proud of, or we might not react in the right way. We might become too emotional. And so conscious breathing shrinks the size of the amygdala. Okay. It stops it from being in that fight or flight mode. Some of us have been in fight or flight our whole life. Okay. Like, and with me, there's no flight. Like I'm all fight. So I have all these issues with my shoulders and my neck because I feel like I've been bowed up my whole life. So I'm breathing and I'm lowering those shoulders. And I'm saying, baby, you okay? You okay? You just settle down. It's okay. There's nothing here you have to fight. You just concentrate on infinite love and gratitude, and it's going to be okay. So some other things that that it helps, it increases your heart rate variability. Your heart rate variability is how quickly you can go from fight or flight to calm again. Okay. And for some people, it takes a long time. Sometimes it might take days. And so the faster that you can do that, you can go from getting triggered to calm again. That's good. You want to be able to do that fast. This increases that ability for you to do that. Okay. Increased heart rate variability is also associated with better executive functioning. Okay. We all need some better executive functioning and not be impulsive. And so this, it also lowers your blood pressure and your heart rate. Okay. How many of us, like I, sometimes guys, I can feel my blood pressure going up. Okay. That's the kind of how passionate kind of a person I am. And I'm like, you just made my blood pressure go up. Okay. I can feel it. Your heart rate, your heart starts beating faster. It can reduce symptoms. And this was the kicker for me. It reduces symptoms of anxiety, insomnia, PTSD, depression, and ADD. Okay. It reduces stress. It increases alertness and it boosts your immune system, guys. Okay. There are case studies of people who have healed their bodies from diseases and sicknesses through conscious breathing and meditating on my body is healing itself. My body knows what to do. For itself to heal itself. And that is just, that blows my mind. So introspection is, it's really getting in touch with your body. It's feeling your body from the inside out. It's like staying with the sensations that you feel and just processing emotions and things that may be upsetting to you, but you can sit through it and you can process it. And when we process stuff, then we can release it. If we just shove stuff down and just, you know, like, everything's okay. I'm putting on my happy face. Everything's okay. Everything's okay. Shove that down. Shove that down. You know, we're shoving so much down. And I'm just going to tell you, the body does not lie. And the body does not forget. And everything you shove down is going to come out. It's going to come out in some type of health issue, some type of symptom. And so we got to deal with stuff, guys. And this is a way that I have found to deal with it. Okay. And it's been life-changing for me. Like, I don't go a day without doing this. I might go without doing my yoga, going through like a whole routine of body moving exercises. You know, there's lots of days when I only have time to do my breath work and my meditation. And, but you know, it's been so life-changing for me, and I can tell the difference when I don't sit and have this time. And when I do sit and have this time, so this morning I'm on my new yoga meditation cushion. I got a cushion because it gets kind of uncomfortable after a while just sitting on the floor. I love sitting crisscross applesauce, you know, like we do in the classroom. And you can sit that way. You can sit on a cushion. You can just sit on a yoga mat. You can just sit in a chair. You want to be in a chair though where your feet touch the floor, and you sit up straight, and you are consciously aware of your breathing. Okay. Breathing that keeps us alive is like a subconscious thing. Like, we don't even think about it. Thank God, because I know I'm the kind of person that I'd forget to breathe. Okay. Because I get so distracted by everything going on and in such a hurry sometimes. So conscious breathing is when you're aware of your breathing, and there's lots of different types of conscious breathing. And different types of breathing really give you different benefits for different parts of the body. But the one that I love, just because it's so easy and it's so simple, it's called box breathing. Okay. So if you just picture a box and think about the four parts of this breathing as being one of the sides of that box. Okay. So when we start out with the box, we're inhaling and then we're holding it and then we're exhaling. And then we're holding that exhale. And then we start over. Inhaling, okay? And me, I love to do a count of eight. I started out like a count of two, because I'm going to tell you, when you first start trying to consciously breathe, you're going to find that you are the most shallow breather. Like, you know, like we're just barely breathing into our, probably the top of our lungs. Like we're probably not even filling our lungs to capacity the way we breathe to live daily. So I started out counting to two, then four, because you're going to find a friend of mine, she said, what does it mean if you can't breathe that deep? You know, well, it just means we're going to work on it. We're going to work on breathing deeply and feeling that breath. Feel through the back of your throat, down through your chest, and all the way into the abdomen, and as far as you can go, even into the hips, if you can feel that breath going into the hips. And so I'm just going to model what I do. So I'm like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And you just continue that way, guys. And you can do it for as short amount of time. Like you may only have 2 minutes in the morning. You might have 10 minutes in the morning, okay? And some mornings I get up and I find that, you know, I can't breathe. Like my stomach does not want to expand when I'm breathing. And I have to consciously think about that. Now we're going to breathe deep and my tummy should be expanding with this big, huge, life-giving breath. And then it should contract when I'm exhaling all of that breath out of my lungs. And so you have to concentrate on it. The next part of conscious breathing is meditation, okay? And meditation is basically, to me, I mean, this is, I'm just going to put it in my terms, meditation is getting quiet, okay? Getting quiet. It doesn't mean that thoughts are not going to pop up into your head, because I'm telling you, they're going to be popping in and bouncing around like monkeys in a tree. Boom, 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 from limb to limb. Things are going to come in. Just let it. Just let those thoughts come in. You might think, why am I thinking about that? Let them come, let them go, and just continue to focus on your breathing, not the box breathing. Once you've done, you know, a few minutes, several minutes of the box breathing, then you're just going to be breathing deep breaths, but you don't have to do the holding in between the inhale and the exhale. And just let the thoughts come, guys, but try to quiet yourself. And I usually pick, you know, one thing that I want to think about. And my thing has been infinite love and gratitude. Okay, I'm a lover. I love me some people, okay? And so focusing on love and wanting to be a vessel that is more full of love for everyone around me has been my focus. And then having gratitude. When we're grateful for the things we have and we concentrate on the things that we have, it increases your happiness, guys. And so those are the two things that I think about. And I'm not just sitting there chanting it, like I don't, but I communicate to the Lord, okay? Like, Lord, fill me with your infinite love. And Lord, fill me with gratitude. Lord, I'm so grateful for everything that you've done in my life. Lord, I'm grateful for every journey that you have brought me through. And I just start naming the things that I'm thankful for. But then I get quiet, guys. And what I have learned through this, what I have learned is that when I am truly quiet, I can hear the Lord's voice speak to me much more clearly. And you know it's true. If you're talking, you're not really listening for anything. So, and prayer is wonderful. I wholeheartedly believe in prayer and the power of prayer. But if you are just praying and you're just giving God this long list and you're just talking and you're just, you know, you're pouring out your heart to him and you're telling him all this stuff that he really already knows, but we're telling him anyway, we don't really hear his voice. Like before I started conscious breathing and meditation, I had heard the audible voice of God in my life several times, okay? And now I realize, Lord, I could have heard you so much more if I had just gotten quiet, if I had just gotten quiet and listened. And so what I've learned is during my meditation time and what I've experienced is once all the crazy random thoughts don't have control of you anymore, like you're not just feeding them and you're not just obsessing over. And most of the thoughts are going to be things that stress us out. It's going to be things that we need to worry about, but we don't need to worry. Okay. Fear not. be still, be anxious for nothing. You know, that's what the Bible tells us. And this supports that. Be still and listen. Don't be anxious. And he just drops these thoughts into my mind. He'll say, Lynn, today, little so-and-so really needs you to focus on this, okay? Today, that sweet little girl, she needs you to really look her in the face and talk to her and spend some time with her. Not about academics. She needs to know that you see her and that you love her. And the things that he tells me are things that when I am in this frenetic world that we live in, when I'm in this anxious, got to do this, got to do that, I don't hear his voice and I miss those opportunities. So this is it's an opportunity for you to become more aware of the people in your life and what they need. It's a time for you to take care of yourself. And, you know, talking about healthy habits this week, guys, and things that we can do, this is a vital part of my morning routine along with my coffee. And right after I finish my coffee, I do my Pink Slim and my Active drink. And normally, coffee and my Slim and Active, that whole time, I'm doing my breathing and my meditation. And then once I finish both of those, then I get into my yoga. But I've realized that if I jump straight up and go try to do my things, I'm a hot mess. I am stressed out. I am already just anxious. I don't even, you know, like I don't know where to turn first. But if I come and I have this time, just me and just concentrating on my breathing and the Lord, we can handle anything. And I get up off of this mat and I feel like I'm at peace. I'm not in that fight or flight stance. I'm not ruled by the anxiety that I would be ruled by had I just jumped up in the morning. And it's a non-negotiable for me. It is vital to my happiness and my zen, okay? So I don't skip this. I get up every morning. I don't even use an alarm clock anymore because I've gotten so used to getting up at 5. I get up and I cannot wait to go to the Keurig and get my coffee and come sit here. And I just start breathing and I just start listening for the Lord to talk to me. And he has not disappointed me one day yet. And I know he will not disappoint you. And I love you guys. And I hope you got something out of this today. And if you have any questions, feel free to message me because I would love to share more about the training in Costa Rica and about what I've learned. And yeah, so I hope you have a happy Tuesday.